good morning. Just so glad to see everyone here. For those of you that are listening on Facebook, this is a little different. It's a little different timing. What's going on is that we have we're meeting in person for the first time in 12 weeks. It's like, yay! This is wonderful. And the rest of the crowd hadn't had as much coffee as I've had. So, but we are here, and we're glad that you're part of this. This is something that we're going to be continuing from here on out. Just bear with us, because this is going to change. And part of the reason for the odd time is we have a copyright license for our music, but we don't have a streaming license yet. So that's the reason why we're kind of getting a moving target, and the time's going to change a little bit every week. But eventually, we're going to look at getting a streaming license, and we're going to hopefully be starting at the same time every week. But it's so good to see everybody. And I have to give a shout out to some people who helped make this possible. And Kai is here now, and her mom, Tara, is running the phone for me, and Ms. Lisa, and Ms. Darlene as well. If it hadn't been for them, and there's Ryland, I can't forget him. They wiped down everything, sanitized everything, and a big, huge shout out to them. And we're just, y'all just don't know. It is a pastor, even though we all met on Facebook, it's just different. It's so good to see all of y'all. And it's each and every one of you. And y'all that are joining us online, you're part of our family. Whether you never set foot here or not. There are a lot of people that can't join, that can't come, they work weekends. We're just glad to see you all. And where two or more gathered, he is there. Now, y'all, going through the announcements, our COVID-19 update, we're wiping down everything, we're airing everything out. And we encourage folks, use your best judgment. If you decide that you want to come before you come see us, you know your health issues. We love you. We love you whether you come here, whether you're listening on Facebook or YouTube. Use your best judgment. We'll be here. And let's see now. Our land, we're still working towards that. And once all this gets settled, we have the name of a builder that we're going to contact and we get an idea for where we need to be at for in order to get us over to our new spot. Now, is... And I want to start us off with some good news. Jackson Gannett, he's a young man that we have followed for probably about 3 years now. He had a horrific car accident. He was, him and his brother and brother's girlfriend coming back from Atlanta from a wrestling camp, and they were hit by a driver. Jackson was never supposed to come home. He was never supposed to talk. He was never supposed to walk. He was never supposed to be back in school. This is Jackson. My son Braden, and I cannot remember this young man's name, but he is Heasley Darby's brother. And that was him at their senior parade. Jackson Gannon is going to be walking at the graduation ceremony this Thursday. Along with my son, a little shout out there. But they're going to be walking, and a miracle. This young man is a walking miracle. He is proof of the power of prayer. And he is just an inspiration for so many. That this young man had so many reasons to complain, and I don't think I've ever seen without a smile on his face in the times I've seen. Also, we have some, I'd like to remember some folks. The first one is Renee Shiplett. Renee's a coworker, former coworker of mine. Renee lost her 3-year battle with cancer just a week or so ago, and she was something else. She was an amazing person in her struggle. She defined what was good in people with her courage and her sense of grace. And I did a message about her. It was a lay on my heart to do it, and that was the most viewed message I've ever done. Is currently at 675 views. And Renee's still touching people. And we want to lift up her husband Steve and their family as they're going through this time. Unfortunately, we've got a lot of folks that are in a rough spot. This is Earl Hall. Earl's wife Rachel has an aunt from where I grew up at. And so she started picking up on my devotional, the Facebook devotionals. And her husband, Earl, contracted COVID. Beginning, I think it was in March or April. Earl ended up spending about 6 or 7 weeks in ICU. They went to a rehab hospital and then basically came home. But Earl passed away suddenly from a blood clot just a couple of days ago. We want to lift his wife, Rachel, up and their family up. And also, I did have a picture of her, but in Justin's girlfriend, her grandmother, Marilyn Obermeyer, passed away suddenly Saturday morning. We want to lift in her family up. Now, y'all, as we go to our prayer list, does anybody have any updates for anyone? Sorry, I'm the... Yes, ma'am.
Lee's sick again.
A little lift, Lee, up.
He's going to take it to hospital sometime. Okay.
Y'all, anybody else that we can ask? Or any updates? And y'all, anyone that's listening, if you put any, if you'll type into the comments or message me, and we'll be glad to add folks to the prayer list, and this also comes on our website as well. Let's see. Oh, y'all, offering. We're not passing around an offering plate right now. Just bear with us. We had to pass around everything twice off. We did. It's in the back by Greg. So we're going to have a short video, and then I'll be back for the message, okay?
What happened that day? When the Spirit arrived, when the Holy Spirit came, what happened then? It got loud. Loud enough to be heard all over town. Fire appeared, divided, and dispersed to each of them. The outsiders came running, and they heard the fire talkers tell God's mighty works in their own language. Parthians, Medes, Elamites, people from Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus, Asia, Phrygia, Pamphylia, Egypt, Libya, Rome, Jews, proselytes, Cretans, and Arabians. The Spirit had come to describe the glory of God in their native tongues through those who followed Christ. These representatives of the world stood astounded, but curious, bewildered, but ready. Then Peter showed them from the scripture exactly what it meant. We've given God's promise to all who trust in Jesus. And many believed, and many repented, and many were baptized, and many were saved. The Spirit had come. The church was born.
Person for the first time in almost 3 months. This period of time has marked a new chapter for our little church and a lot of other churches, and I think really for our country. There's a mix of uncertainty and optimism in the air inside the church walls. Most of us have been able to reach more people than we've ever been able to. I know here at Genesis, we've actually been able to reach out to more people during our when we started this, we counted folks from 18 different states that have been able to join us online, and we're very thankful to have everyone, whether you're in person or online, either one. As a country, as a people, we've seen our first responders and our healthcare workers, law enforcement, store clerks, truck drivers, teachers, and so many more have their finest hour. Working and doing what they do in the face of a real uncertainty. Unfortunately, there's also been a firestorm of events that have happened in our country as well. There's a lot of hate going on, a lot of destruction, disease, greed, and selfishness at an epic pace. Then the tragedies of life have not stopped due to COVID-19. The pandemic has increased addictions and relapses at an epic rate. It is just took such a toll. Folks have been uncertain about so many things, and they only know one way to cope. struggling, cancers, and surgeries that can't be done or just starting to be done now because hospitals had to divert so many of their resources. Mental illness, among other things. There are so many things. Life didn't stop. We just didn't hear about it as much. All these things were coming together as our churches start to reopen. So I prayed about the message to talk to you about this morning. I was led to a section of scripture and some early Christians who were, they were in quite a fix. And I realized as I read the scripture, I'm looking at my calendar, I realized we're approaching the anniversary of the time that's written by. Where we're going to go to is the book of Acts, chapter 2. We're just going to look through bits and pieces of the chapter. Now, some background on Acts, it was actually written by Luke the apostle, Luke the physician. And the more I learned about the Bible, the more amazing it is to me that I always had this idea that it was just start to end on a timeline. And it gets this old boy confused sometimes. Well, Luke actually wrote two books, Luke and Acts. Acts is a continuation of Luke. If you put them and read them side by side, and I don't know why they were placed, why they weren't placed one after another, but John was right in the middle of that. But anyway, we're looking at that. In the beginning of the book of Acts, Jesus had spent some time with his disciples before he went back to heaven. He told them in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you'll be my witnesses, telling people about me everywhere in Jerusalem, throughout Judea and Samaria, to the ends of the earth." Then he rose up through the clouds in heaven. How many of us ever felt like God's kind of done that to us? It'll be okay, and it just goes on up. Like he's just flooded it out of your life. I've been that way before. I think a lot of us have. So there were about 120 followers of Jesus at this time. And they gathered on the day of Pentecost. And they were all together in one house, one place. Pentecost, or the Jewish word for Shabbat, it occurs about 50 days after Passover. What it does, it marks the anniversary. Celebrates two things. The end of the barley harvest, which was really important, because Judea was still largely, it was an agricultural society. Also, it marks the anniversary of when God gave Moses the Ten Commandments on Mount Sinai and came down. It's always been celebrated 50 days after Passover. And that was 3,000 years ago, where Passover and Pentecost got started. In Deuteronomy chapter 4, Moses reminded the people, "Remember this day you stood before the Lord your God." And that's where they made the covenant. And I didn't really understand this. Passover was the physical liberation when people were freed from Egypt. This, Pentecost, and Pentecost gets its name from Penta 50. That's the Greek name for it. So 50 days between Passover and Pentecost. Physical liberation of the people. Then a spiritual liberation, where the law is given and God completes his agreement with the people. They're tied in together. God, the more I learn about him, the more I learn about the Bible, things aren't ever done by coincidence. There are a lot of people, if you take apart the Passover, piece by piece, the way they eat the meal, the way it's designed, if you look at elements of it, and you look at the life of Jesus, they're the same thing. The unblemished lamb that has to be eaten. The bitter herbs, which are tears. The Passover was realized through Jesus and his sacrifice. The blood that kept permanent death away that was sprayed on the door, stop the doorways of the Israelites is the blood of Jesus. If you look at all the elements of it, and today, that date, God was going to make something else. And it was going to come to 120 people, scared to death, uncertain, because the area of the world they're at right now, they have a dictatorial government that was just demolishing their whole way of life. They were cast as outsiders from the normal. They were literally afraid for their way of life. They were afraid for their lives, but they were gathered together, a huddling mass, a holy huddle, and they didn't know what was coming, but they felt the need to be together, uncertain about what tomorrow was going to bring. I can only imagine how they felt. Afraid, alone, confused, hurt, abandoned. These are familiar feelings to all of us. All of us. We've all been there. We've all experienced this. And then God moves. Verse 2. And suddenly there came from heaven a noise like a violent rushing wind. It filled the whole house they were sitting in. And early houses in Palestine had very few windows. Very few windows. They were kind of dark and dank. They were made out of mud and almost like an adobe. And this wind comes in. It wasn't a coincidence that Luke described the Holy Spirit as the wind. Jesus did the same thing. In John 3, verse 8, Jesus said, "The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear the sound of it, but do not know where it comes from and where it's going." So is everyone who's born of the Spirit. And then verse 3, there appeared to them tongues of fire distributing themselves, and they rested on each one of them. Also find the Holy Spirit comes in fire. Again, this is a reference back to Exodus. Not only did they hear the Spirit, but they saw it as well. They saw fire appear and the little flames came up. Fire was real important. How did God appear to Moses? In Exodus 3, a flaming bush, a burning bush. He was burning to show the holiness of God. There's always symmetry in everything God does. There are times I get amazed by things I read my whole life and I didn't really realize. It didn't even dawn on me. Sometimes God will move like wind. We don't see him, but we know he's there. When that particular thing that you need is there, we don't know how it got there. Chances of it happening are too astronomical to count. We might feel him, but we don't see him. Sometimes he wants to be seen. He wants to be known. The very Spirit of God was moving among these people. But they were lost. And they didn't know what the next day was going to bring. They was about to take up residence in the forest. They saw the fire come to each one of them. They didn't quite know what was going to happen, but God was going in each one of them to do the work of the church. It's no coincidence that they heard and they saw the Holy Spirit. As believers, we're supposed to be able to hear the gospel and speak about Jesus to others. It doesn't have to be fancy. It doesn't have to do all the research I do for these messages. Just pray. Look, ask for the open. Ask for the guidance. A lot of times, we can't help people by just acting, by just being who we are. Showing them a smile. Having a word for them, or more importantly, a lot of times just having an ear for them. And these folks became filled with the Holy Spirit and speaking in other tongues as the Spirit was giving them utterance. And there are other churches where you still have something going on. Hey, that's where all this started, here, this day. And then the next verses go on, like the video said, there were people from all over the known world. Passover, Passover and Pentecost drew people from all over. There were people from three continents in Jerusalem right now, right there on that day. To give you an idea, just like in Turkey alone, there's probably close to 100 dialects, 100 different languages. Even though Rome ruled a lot of this, Latin and Greek were far from the only language spoken. These people were speaking in these tongues, they were able to understand. And some of the people were like, how are these people doing this? Most people from Galilee, and that wasn't common. Galilee was kind of like a roughneck place, and it wasn't considered a compliment at all for me. I come from a small town, I considered one, but a lot of folks didn't when they read this. And then some people said, they're full of sweet wine, and implying they were drunk. When we turn our lives over to Jesus, we start acting differently. When we start following God's word instead of what the world is trying to tell us, it seems odd. When people are using the world as their standard for how people should behave, when they see a believer, they look odd to them, and they act odd to them. The Holy Spirit comes out of nowhere sometimes. It may not make a sound, but it makes this appearance known. This group of believers had to be praying. The Bible doesn't say it. Boom. Like the saying goes, when you're on your knees, you might as well be praying. And this group is on their knees. Like a lot of us are today. Different situations. But all of us have a struggle. All of us. I'm sure doubt has started sinking in. I think we all have that happen sometimes. I know I have my periods of doubt. I'd be lying if I stood up here and said I do. This ability to speak in another language is a very deliberate gift. The church was born. Jesus' church was born to spread the gospel. That's the last command he left us in Matthew. Today, the Holy Spirit might not give us the ability to speak Greek, or Arabic, or Spanish, it gets to something more important. The ability to speak to someone who is in such pain that they won't respond to anything else. That one little crack in that person's wall that might help you to get in there, and it may not be saying anything, but you might be just listening. At that point in time where you need to be there to listen. Holy Spirit wants to work in us and through us. Now Peter, having heard all this, came out with his disciples to all this crowd. And he's telling them, first, we're not drunk. It's only like 10 o'clock in the morning. So we're not there yet. Then he started quoting the prophet Joel and King David. In Joel chapter 6, there was a mention, in the last days, God said, I'll pour out my spirit upon the people, your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions, and your old men will dream dreams. In these days, I'll pour out my spirit even on my servants, men and women alike, and they'll prophesy. I want you to think about what's going on right now. Think about Peter. Peter, there was like a 90-some% illiteracy rate in Palestine. Very few people could read and write. This man was a fisherman by trade. This man had denied Jesus 3 times. Had slept when he was supposed to be guarded. But Peter was redeemed. Even in the middle, he didn't know what was going to happen. He was wanting, fearful for his life. This man was redeemed. The Holy Spirit worked through him. This man became the first bishop of the church in Rome, the first pope. Him and Paul were responsible for the rise of the modern church. And this man spoke about scripture and prophecy and was powerful more than the most educated. because of what it's all in, not because of what the world is all in. He was flawed, just like the rest of us. But at this point in time, he's allowing the Holy Spirit to work through him. And amazing things are happening. After Peter finished speaking, the crowd asked, "What should we do?" Peter's advice, it still applies today. First, humble yourself. Can't say that enough. Humble yourself. I have been guilty of trying to fix stuff or do stuff for God. God, look what I did. No, God can take care of it on his own. God wants to work through me. God don't want me to do it. How many times have we tried to fix stuff? I've been there. I've done it. I still find myself guilty of doing it. And it's hard not to. And I find myself having to go through my reasoning. Why am I doing this? Am I doing it for God's glory? Or am I doing it so Mark will be a good fellow in God's eyes? A lot of times I come up with the answer that I really didn't want to hear. Humble yourself. Repent of your sins. We all got them. Every last one of us. Every last one of us is a struggle. It's a day-to-day struggle. We all struggle. We all do. Help me to do better. And in our struggles, we become closer. And that's as good as we can hope for. And ask God for forgiveness when we mess up. Because we all do it. We all, like, snap at our other halves. We all have a bit of road rage. And I'm a work in progress on that. I'm very much a work in progress on that. I'll have co-workers sometimes that we pray for patience because we pray for strength and we throw punch them. And so we just so have that to deal with. And so we're trying to do better. Accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior. Acknowledging He is the way, the truth, and the life. There's something in our society that goes on, I call it the God of pizza, that we want some of this and some of this, but we don't want some of this. When you accept Jesus, truly accept Him, you accept all of it. You accept His way. You accept His rules. A relationship, a true, healthy relationship, there's parts from both sides that you got to have. You got to have in order to maintain the marriage. It's a friendship, partnership, marriage. There's give and take on both sides and responsibilities on both sides. Baptism, in the name of Jesus Christ. Baptism is just a symbol. It is. But it's one of the two things Jesus did during his lifetime. He was baptized, and he did the first Last Supper, which we would be doing, but we don't have the little separate container things today. We're ordering them, but it's going to take a little while. Be humble enough and willing enough to listen to God's plan instead of our own. I have prayed so many times, God, I got this word out. And you remember like on the detective shows where they have the pictures and they have the string all tied in together to make the, that was me. Silence. Opportunities, I thought for opportunities, the doors never opened, and I couldn't understand why. Years ago, I had applied for a flight nurse position. Lisa and I had just started dating. And she was not great. It was in Charlotte. We had just started dating. And I didn't get the position. It was for a Carolina's Medical Center. And at that time, I was a lot lighter and had good knees and was just really gung-ho. People that knew me when I was at the bedside, I really enjoyed nursing and respiratory therapy. I really did. And I didn't get the position. And I didn't understand why. I had the whole, like, the map with the strings and the pictures and everything else. And my mother-in-law sitting over here smiling because she remembers my other half was not real thrilled when I did it, but she let me interview with it. Because we'd been dating about 2 months at that time. And I didn't understand. And it bothered me. And as I look back on it, when I was writing this, I look back on it. Now I realize God force-fed His plan to me, and I'm so glad He did. His plan ended up being so much better than mine. I would have missed out on being a daddy to one of the best things that ever happened to me. And Lisa and Braden, they're a reason for all this gray hair, but I wouldn't miss it, not a day. I love you, honey. I know you're going to be listening to this later. But be willing to listen to God. Ask for His plan and stay yours. Now, verses 41 and 42. People in this crowd, they received Peter's words, they were baptized. That 120 people went to 3,000 in a day. 3,000. And they took this little known religion back to Africa, Egypt, Libya. They took it to Asia, modern day Turkey, the Arabian Peninsula. They took it all over Europe. Ordinary people. Ordinary people. Those people were just like us. No Christian then or now is perfect. A lot of times Christians are led into sin. Christians are. We'll be the first ones to tell you we struggle, and you got it right. Anyone that ever labels a church as anything other than a hospital for the spiritual sick, you got it wrong. A true church family, we all struggling through this together. We may not have an answer for you, but we're going to keep praying, we're going to keep loving. And we'll go through the bad times together, we'll go through the good times together. We'll have a church for a baby shower and a wedding. We'll have a church for a funeral service. We will be there for each other. That's what being a Christian really is. You're there in good times and bad times. We're flawed. There are times I had a coworker this week and had to remind me what my other job was, because my temper was running hot by something. She had to remind me she really didn't. Good lady, she's a good little man. And I realized, why did I get hot and bothered? Because it wasn't doing anything. This ain't worth it. Sometimes our faith can run cold when we ask why things happen. And that's natural. I do. I ask why things happen. There are things I'm not going to understand in this world. There are things we all won't understand in this world. But we can pray. We keep struggling. And we struggle together. Even now, the Holy Spirit wants to work in our lives, doing God's work in our own scheme. You might be sitting there saying, how can you use me? I'm not a speaker. I don't teach. I don't have this or that. One question, have you got a willing heart? Have you got a willing heart? There have been more people saved on a riverbank or in a Waffle House probably than they have in a lot of churches. There are people who came to Christ in parking lots, and it wasn't some fancy speaker, it wasn't a pastor, it was someone willing to listen and say, I don't have all the answers, but I have Jesus. And I know He's been with me through my storms. Let Him be with you. You don't have to be alone. Because that's the true hell. Hell isn't the fire and the brimstone. Even now, we do not have separation from God, even if you disavow God, which I have. When my daughter passed away, I didn't believe in God, and I did. I was kicking him for a couple of years. He never left me. When we're here on this earth, we are not separated from God. If we go to hell, we are separated from God for eternity. That's the true hell. As we go to prayer this morning, ask for the Holy Spirit to use you. All of us have this thing inside of us that we can use, that He can use in us. It may not be fancy. It might be that you're a good cook and you know that someone is struggling. They lost their husband, they lost their wife, they're struggling. It may be that maybe you're an expert cleaner and you know that there's a neighbor that they're hurting and they can't come. something about when you lose someone and the world goes back to running. I know when my ex-wife and I lost our daughter and the world started back running again. Well, wait a minute. This should not be happening. And there are so many people that go on that have to deal with that. And there's just a little reminder. We love you. And we're praying for you. We're praying for better days. And we're praying for comfort. You'll never be the same. When you have something that you love so much, for a modern day Pentecost, a mule, not just the Genesis church. We're blessed with the church family that we have. What we lack in size and what we lack in building all that, we make up for it because we got some good folks that pray for each other and they've been with each other through good times and bad. But praying for all of God's churches, we've got churches that are struggling. And I don't mean just financially, we've got churches that are struggling spiritually. We've got churches that the Holy Spirit is not being in them all the time. We've got churches that are more concerned with what you're wearing than what's in your heart and your need to be with Jesus and be with people for Jesus. That's not good. We got people that are standing at the doors of some of these churches saying, "Where's your tie at?" That's not good. We have people that are struggling. We have people that are hurting. We have churches where the Holy Spirit has not been in so long. We need a revival of God's people. Not the bricks and the walls, but God's people. We need a revival of God's people in this country. Because all this hate and darkness, you don't use more hate and darkness to drive out hate and darkness. You use peace, light, and love. And a lot of innocent people being hurt, a lot of lives being destroyed over a lot of hate. And I pray that we're going to be people we need to be, and we're also going to be there and help other folks to see there's a better way. We ain't got to deal like this. I don't hate you because I'm different from you. Don't hate me because I'm different. I don't want to destroy anything. More power to you that you've worked up in when you build all this. We need a modern day Pentecost. We need a revival. We need to be a presence in our workplace, in our families, at the voting booths. We need to be a presence for our kids, for our families, guys and girls. But we want our kids to always be better than us, and we got to be their home, and we got to show them who we are. And just to end, one last thing, and y'all heard me say it before, just imagine a world where everybody is in church, everybody is listening to this, help one person. Help one person where everybody knows. I don't need to go out and give them a pile of money. Just listen to them. A card, a call, something. Ask the Holy Spirit, go to prayer. How can I help this person that's waiting on my heart? You'll find a way. Let me get everybody to stand with me. We're going to go to the Lord in prayer, and then the songs will be going, and the altars will be open. Please come and pray this later on your heart. Heavenly Father, we come to you today. Father, it's kind of a holy hug. There are churches all over this country, and we're looking at what's going on in this country right now, Father, and we're shocked and we're discouraged, and some of us are afraid. And Father, we're afraid for our children. We're afraid for what's going to happen with this disease and violence and so many other things. Father, we ask for you to come, for the Holy Spirit to come into these churches, to come into every person that's listening online, for all these church services, Father. Show them the Holy Spirit. Help them to understand. Help them to see it, feel it, hear it, and obey it. Help us to have humble hearts. They're willing to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Humble minds, Father, that we're willing to go out and be the kind of people that you want us to be 7 days a week. Not 1 hour a week, the whole 168 hours. Father, we don't have to stand on the street corner, but we live by your rules during our lives. We're going to touch and affect someone. Father, help us to do that. Give us the strength. Give us the bravery to do that, because it can be worth it. It can be scary to stand out from the crowd and be different. Father, everyone that's listening to this, help your words to be heard, not mine. They don't need to hear my words. They need to hear yours. Tattoo it on our hearts. Give us the light as we go out in this dark world. In Jesus' name we pray.